In many countries, consumer credit markets are heavily regulated and have been especially scrutinized in the wake of the 2008 financial crisis. This often takes the form of interest rate regulations, and, in particular, caps on the rates that lenders are allowed to charge. Yet, despite their ubiquity, interest rate caps are a controversial policy tool. While they are intended to protect consumers from high interest rates, some argue they may actually hurt consumers by cutting riskier borrowers entirely out of the market. To illustrate this tension, consider two individuals who apply for a loan. One is low risk, while the other is high risk, meaning that he has a higher probability of defaulting and failing to repay his loan. The interest rate charged to each borrower can be decomposed into the marginal cost to the bank of making that loan. In other words, the interest rate that allows the bank to just break even, plus a markup. Note that the marginal cost, and thus the overall interest rate, on this loan is higher. This reflects that even in a world where banks made zero profits, riskier borrowers would be charged higher rates to account for the greater likelihood that they fail to repay their loan. So, what happens when we introduce an interest rate cap? On the one hand, this forces the bank to reduce its profit margin on this loan, which benefits the low-risk borrower. But if the cap is set below the marginal cost of lending to the high-risk borrower, the bank will no longer be willing to lend to this borrower at all. This is the central trade-off faced by policymakers. While a cap lowers interest rates for those consumers who are able to get a loan, it potentially restricts credit access for riskier borrowers. What does this look like in the real world? How large are the consumer protection benefits versus the credit access costs of these policies, and how do we weigh them against one another? This paper tackles those questions by studying the effects of regulatory reforms in the Chilean consumer credit market. Interest rate caps have been implemented in various forms in this market since the 1920s, and the authors focus on a set of policy changes enacted in December 2013. Prior to the reform, caps were set separately for loans above and below the $8,000 threshold. After the reform, the category of smaller loans was divided into those above and below $2,000, and a series of reductions were phased in over the following two-year period. By December 2015, the interest rate cap on loans below $2,000 had been brought down by 16.9 percentage points, while the cap on loans between $2,000 and $8,000 had been brought down by 23.9 percentage points. Over the same period, the cap on larger loans remained relatively unaffected. These figures show the effect of the reforms on the rates actually paid by borrowers. Comparing the distribution of interest rates before and then after the reforms shows that they did in fact force lenders to reduce their interest rates. In contrast, and as seen before, larger loans were relatively unaffected. So the question is, how did these tighter limits on interest rates affect borrowers? The authors trace out the causal effects of the reforms by comparing outcomes between treatment and control groups, both before and after the reform. The results show first that the reforms were effective in lowering borrowers' interest rates. Average rates fell by 9% in the post-reform period, with larger declines for high-risk borrowers. At the same time, however, there was also a sharp decline in the number of loans made to this group, with the quantity of loan contracts falling by 19%. This is the trade-off between consumer protection and credit access. While interest rate caps make credit more affordable for those who are able to get a loan, they also cut riskier borrowers out of the market entirely. Overall, average monthly payments decreased by $3.26 as a result of the stronger interest rate regulations, This amounts to aggregate savings for borrowers of over $31 million in present value per year. On the other hand, over 150,000 fewer loans were made as a result of the reforms, totaling over $360 million in lost credit. So how do we evaluate the overall impact of these policies? If some consumers benefit from lower interest rates, but others lose credit access entirely, how do we determine the desirability of these policies from an aggregate perspective? To answer this question, the authors develop an economic model that allows them to estimate borrowers' willingness to pay for credit. This is a key quantity, as the central question is whether the value of lower interest payments for this group outweighs the cost of restricted credit access for this group. And what they find is that not only did the majority of consumers in this setting lose from tighter regulation, their losses were also larger in magnitude than the gains of those who benefited from them. Consumer surplus decreased by $38 on average for 84.3% of consumers, was unchanged for 1%, and increased by only 60 cents on average for the remainder. In other words, the cost of losing access to credit outweighed the benefits of paying lower rates conditional on getting a loan. Note that these results might differ in other settings. For example, the authors show that the adverse effects can be alleviated by using risk-based caps, which set different limits for different borrowers according to their risk profile. Nonetheless, this paper provides evidence that these kinds of consumer protection regulations can have unintended consequences. As always, you can check out the full paper and its references to other related research. These include other papers studying interest rate regulations, research more broadly on regulating credit markets, and papers on the pros and cons of consumer access to expensive credit, many of which focus on the payday lending industry in the US.